اللهم علمنا ما ينفعنا وانفعنا بما علمتنا وزدنا علما وفقها في الدين يا رب العالمين. اللهم افتح علينا بحكمتك وانشر علينا برحمتك يا ذا الجلال والإكرام. Inshallah, tonight we are starting a new series. We trying to educate ourselves about the qasas of Al-Quran, the stories of Al-Quran. And the stories of Al-Quran is a very important and very powerful subject. And when we go to the books of hadith on the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, this is the book of Allah, fihi naba'u man qablakum. In it, there are the news of those who are before you. And these are the qasas of Al-Quran. And many of the ulama, many of the scholars of Quran, they said that almost one third of the events in the Quran is from Al-Qasas. And even there are verses and chapters in the Quran, suwar, named after some of the qasas. For example, there is surah called Surah Al-Qasas, just by itself. But there is Surah Nuh, there is Surah Hud. And it speaks about the stories of these great prophets of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who created the human being and He created the human soul, and He knows subhanahu wa ta'ala the human nature, Allah knows the power of the story. And the power of the story cannot be underestimated or overlooked. And by many civilizations and cultures that came before us, used the power of storytelling for many purposes, for social, political, and cultural purposes. And that started, as we know, in ancient Greece with the Greek theater. All that was storytelling. It was the Roman Colosseums and all these arts of theater, opera, Hollywood. What Hollywood, many people complain of Hollywood's impact on culture. Hollywood impact on not only American culture, but basically on world culture. Well, what is Hollywood? What are these things that come out of Hollywood? There are stories. And Hollywood is a storyteller. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created the human being. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows the power of storytelling. And what people can take out of the stories. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala filled His glorious book of Al-Quran with stories. And these stories are, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala described as, these are the best stories. It is not those stories that get the rewards, the best-selling book list, the Oscars. It is, these are the best stories. And it's really painful and hurtful to see some of our Islamic youth forgetting, or even some of our Muslim brothers and sisters, and we advise and admonish ourselves first, that we should not leave these most beautiful stories and go seek stories somewhere else. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told us that in this book, we have put for you the best of stories. And look no further. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah Yusuf, He said, بعد أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم نحن نقص عليك أحسن القصص بما أوحينا إليك هذا القرآن وإن كنت من قبله لمن الغافلين. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, we do relate unto you the most beautiful of stories. In this book there is and there are the most beautiful of stories. In what that we revealed to you this Quran, before this you were among those who knew it not. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala illustrated in the book itself, in the glorious Quran itself, the importance of storytelling. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, one of the most important function of a story is after you listen to the story and you understand the meaning of the story, you ponder on the story. You ponder over the meaning, you contemplate. And those who do not contemplate, who read these stories, even the Quranic stories, for entertainment, they are heedless people. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala not to make us of them. When we listen to this Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, أَفَلَا يَتَدَبَّرُونَ الْقُرْآنَ أَمْ عَلَىٰ قُلُوبٍ أَقْفَالُهَا. Do not they contemplate over these verses of Quran, or their hearts are locked. Their heart are hardened, cannot open to these beautiful meanings of Quran. And the stories are part of Quran. We cannot, as I said in the beginning of this, underestimate the power of that teaching tool, the tool of wisdom that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala placed in this book. And he said, فَقْصُصِ الْقَصَصِ, told his prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the prophets before him, tell, relate the stories. Why? Why should you tell them stories? لَعَلَّهُمْ يَتَفَكَّرُونَ, so they may reflect. They may ponder upon the meaning of these stories. These stories are not just to spend an evening and be entertained. These stories are for you to take home, to ponder upon it and read it again, reflect upon it, and read more Quran, and learn more wisdom, more hikmah. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said that there is always in every story there is a hikmah, and there is a ibrah. There are instructions. Quran is not a history book. It is not a book of tales. It is a book of wisdom, al-kitab al-hakim. It is a book that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala anzala bil-haq. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed it with the truth. It is the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And these stories are not in vain. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said about these stories and the stories of the prophets and the nations before us, and all narrated in the book of Allah, لَقَدْ كَانَ فِي قَصَصِهِمْ عِبْرَةٌ لِأُولِي الْأَلْبَابِ. Indeed, there is in their stories instructions, there are lessons in there for people of understanding. These stories and these lessons and these instructions are out there for you, but you have to open your mind, you have to open your heart to receive that. And it also serves a very important objective beyond the extracting the wisdom and the lessons. And it has a practical aspect, these stories. And that practical aspect is to support each one of us as we go through life, like it did for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And he is our example, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He is our role model. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, this is part of the reasons why we have revealed stories for you, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He said, وَكُلَّا نَقُصُّ عَلَيْكَ مِنْ أَنْبَاءِ الرُّسُلِ مَا نُثَبِّتُ بِهِ فُؤَادَكَ. And that we relate to you of the stories of the messenger, with it, we make your heart firm. We give you steadfastness. We make you strong by these stories. When the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in one of the worst days of his life, when he was in a Ta'if, and he was sallallahu alaihi wasallam chased by children that were throwing stones on him, and he was bleeding, and they tried to humiliate his honorable face sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he told Aisha in a Sahih hadith that was one of the hardest days of his life. What did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala remind him with? How did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala come to the aid of his beloved prophet? He sent him a slave that gave him some grapes. But how is that related to this story? Why is that a story? Because that slave started chatting with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, who was in a very hard moment. He was being tested to the limit sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. It appeared like his da'wah failed in Mecca. And he's been expelled from Mecca. Many do not understand when we read that story that the Prophet ﷺ could not go back to Mecca after he left to Al-Ta'if. He had to come under a protection of one of the kuffar to be able to come back to his house. So he was ﷺ being tested. And Rasulullah ﷺ said, the most people that are tested, the harshest test, the hardest test, are given to the prophets. And who is the best of creation? Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. He was given a harshest test at that particular day. So this is where we bring in that up, the point, the stories. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and it is not a coincidence, send him a slave to bring him some grapes because he felt sorry for the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. So they started chatting. And he said, where are you from? And that slave name was Addas. And he said, أنا من نينوى. I'm from Nainawa. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, من بلد الصالح يونس بن متى. You are from the town where Eunice was, the story. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was reminded through the character of Addas with the story of Eunice, who was tested hard, and he was pushed to the limit, and his people would not respond to him, and he left them and went away. And this is when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam goes back to Mecca. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam will never abandon his da'wah, and will never abandon that mission. But that is the power of the story. And this is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, نُثَبِّتُ بِهِ فُؤَادَكَ. We make you stronger. When you listen to the sabr of Ayyub, the patience of Ayyub, and the patience of Nuh, and the patience of Isa, and how Musa tolerated the harm and the harshness of his own people, then you become stronger. And that's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reminds his beloved Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, فَصْبِرْ كَمَا صَبَرَ أُولُو الْعَزْمِ مِنَ الرُّسُلِ. Be patient, persevere, like those before you were patient and persevered. And how does the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam knows how they persevered and why, how they were patient? Because of the stories. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told them the stories. And that is why there is that factor that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us strength. When we go through hard times, and then we start reading some of these verses. If we are sick, we remember Ayyub. If we are in jail, we remember Yusuf. If we are being tormented by others, we remember the stories of the Sahaba that is narrated there. If Muslims are defeated, they read in the Quran, Uhud. These are the stories of this book. And it is not only to strengthen the heart of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, but this book is forever. And this is for us. This is for humanity. So our heart would be strengthened, as we will see inshallah, as we will try in our humble attempt to read into these stories, like every Muslim should. We will see how, inshallah, we will all grow stronger. We will all grow more wise, more understanding of how history works, of how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala plans things, how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala supports those who believe. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says about these stories, these are not tales. These are not fiction. These are not novels. They are truth. These things are not there to say, well, these are legendary characters, and I cannot follow in tracks of legendary characters. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks in these qasas about our role models, the prophets, the followers of the prophets, the people of knowledge, the knowledgeable man who was with Musa, Mu'min Yasin, the believer of Surah Yasin, Mu'min al-Fir'aun, normal people, not only prophets. The believer of Fir'aun, of the family of Fir'aun. And Allah tells us the good, the bad, and the ugly. Tells it all. People who lost track. People who went in the wrong direction, went to the dark side. وَالْعِيَاذُ بِاللَّهِ. And people who steadfast, who were patient and persevered throughout the test that where they were put through by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, these are true accounts. This is, إِنَّ هَذَا لَهُوَ الْقَصَصُ الْحَقِّ وَمَا مِنْ إِلَٰهٍ إِلَّا اللَّهِ وَإِنَّ اللَّهَ لَهُوَ الْعَزِيزُ الْحَكِيمُ. And these are the true stories. And there is no God other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And He is indeed the all-glorious, exalted in power, and He is the all-wise. The stories of Quran had some characteristics. Number one, it clarifies for us the methods of da'wah. And we are all du'at. And those who are not practicing da'wah, we have shortcomings that we have to support each other and work to overcome these shortcomings. But we see the methods, how these prophets approached people, how they went into a society that had no believers other than themselves. It is narrated, like we will see in the story of Nuh alayhi salam, that he لبث في قومه ألف سنة إلا خمسين عاما. He stayed in his people 1,000 years, a millennium, minus 50 years. And how many ما آمن معه إلا قليل. How many believed? How many went with him? Very few. But we see the method, the perseverance, the persistence of his da'wah. And it clarifies that for us. And it also shows us that all the messages came with a united message. All the messengers of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they had one theme. The aqidah, the creed, is the same. That doesn't change. It is the same message from Adam to Nuh to Idris to Musa to Isa to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, going with all the prophets. That is, worship Allah and associate none with the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We read in Surah Nuh, اعبدوا الله ما لكم من إله غيره. Worship Allah. There is no God other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Tawheed. إِنِّي لَكُمْ مِنْهُ نَذِيرٌ مُبِينٌ. I am a messenger. I am a warner. A clear warner for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What does that say? لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ نُوحًا رَسُولُ اللَّهِ. This is the message. And did it change? It doesn't change. لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ مُوسَى رَسُولُ اللَّهِ. لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ عِيسَى رَسُولُ اللَّهِ. لا إله إلا الله محمد رسول الله خاتم الأنبياء وسيد المرسلين. The creed is the same. The Sharia will change. The Sharia changes. What it was haram for Israel, for the people of Israel, may not be haram for the Muslims. And what is halal for the followers of Isa عليه السلام may not be halal for the followers of Muhammad عليه السلام. But that is the Sharia. That is Sharia, that is law, that is jurisprudence. But not the creed. All the prophets of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala came with the same message. And that is important to understand. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has one fact, one word, and humans play with it. Humans change that. Not Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and not the messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we will see, inshallah, during these sessions, that theme will repeat itself, and it will show itself. And also gives us knowledge. The stories of these prophets gives us knowledge, so we can debate and talk to other nations. Because there is always, we said in the methods of da'wah, you start with something common between you and others. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala started with the kuffar of Quraysh by the simple fact that they all understand and believe in that Allah created heavens and earth. So he said to his prophet, ask them, مَنْ خَلَقَ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ لَإِنْ سَأَلْتَهُمْ مَنْ خَلَقَ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ لَيَقُولُنَّ اللَّهِ. If you ask them who created heavens and earth, they will say Allah. That's the point to start. And when you speak and debate with the people of the book, we have a lot of things in common. A lot of mutual stories that we build on and show them what this religion is made of and the truth of the Islam. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the Sahaba in Medina were challenged by this. When they started communicating and interacting with the Jews of Medina and then later on with the Christians that came from Yemen, they would challenge the Muslims with some stories. Like the Jews came and sent some news to Mecca, and they asked the people of Quraysh to ask the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to test him, to see if he's truly a prophet. They asked him about Ashab al-Kahf. They asked him about the people of the cave. They asked him about Dhul Qarnayn. And they asked him about Ar-Ruh. They gave him questions. And how did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala respond? By stories of the Quran. To show that the source is absolutely authentic. And it is absolutely true. And that all goes through these stories of Quran. And you get also examples of the disbelievers, examples of the unbelievers in the stories of Quran. You speak about the story of Qarun. What does Qarun represent? Someone who was blinded by their wealth. Someone who felt the arrogance of the power that they had in their money. And they thought they need none but nobody. No, they don't need Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And they felt they make their own wealth. When Qarun was asked, why don't you worship Allah and He provided you with all that wealth? He said, إِنَّمَا أُوتِيتُهُ عَلَىٰ عِلْمٍ عِنْدِي. I was given this because I have knowledge. I'm smart. I know how to trade. I'm good in the market. We speak about the people of the two gardens and how one was completely deviated by the glorious garden that he had. And he became a kafir. He said, مَا أَظُنُّ السَّاعَةَ قَائِمَةً. I don't think that there is a day of judgment by what he had. We hear about Fir'aun, the role model for all tyrants all over time, Fir'aun. And inshallah, when we study the story of Musa alayhi salam and analyze, you will see that there's a lot of benefit, not in only analyzing the stories, but in analyzing the character of Fir'aun, the character of the disbeliever, to understand how deviated and how misguided they are and where they come from. And then you have the opposite, the examples, how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala always support the believers. And Allah knows we need that in these times. We need to know these stories, al-qasas al-haq, the true stories. Because we are living today, brothers and sisters, in time of despair. Time many Muslims start asking themselves, what is going on? Ayna nasrullah? Where is the support of Allah? Aren't we on the true religion? Aren't we on the right path? What is going on here? And the stories of the Quran will explain to us what is going on here. Because not only what is known in the common language, we say history repeats itself. Muslims, we don't say that. We said, لَن تَجِدَ لِسُنَّةِ اللَّهِ تَبْدِيلًا. You will not find any change in the method of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is all wise and all knowing, and He's persistent throughout history. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is in charge of history. And we have to understand that we are in the hands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And these stories are for us to learn and to go on and implement the benefit that we get into our life, to support our spirit, to support our souls, to teach our children these beautiful stories, to raise Muslims for the coming times. The coming times are the times of Muslims, no doubt, brothers and sisters. There is no doubt, inshallah, about this. That this is, إِلَىٰ إِنَّ وَعْدَ اللَّهِ حَقٍّ. The promise of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is true. What did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala promise? وَعْدَ اللَّهُ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ لَيَسْتَخْلِفَنَّهُمْ فِي الْأَرْضِ وَلَيُبَدِّلَنَّهُمْ مِنْ بَعْدِ خَوْفِهِمْ أَمْنًا يَعْبُدُونَنِي لَا يُشْرِكُونَ بِي شَيْئًا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala promised the believers that they worship Allah and they do the righteous deeds, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give them their safety and will give them the power that they need to protect themselves. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told us in these stories, إِنَّ اللَّهَ يُدَافِعُ عَنِ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا. Allah defends Himself those who believe. You don't need to go to a superpower. Allah is the ultimate power in this universe. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, I am with those who believe. And if you don't believe that, read the stories of Quran. See how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saved the people of Israel, the followers of Musa alayhi salam, when they were squeezed between an army, and they are armless, between an army that wants to slaughter them and wipe them out, and the sea. إِنَّ اللَّهَ يُدَافِعُ عَنِ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا. Allah split the sea open for them. And these are miracles. And some say, well, the time of miracle is gone. It is not gone. And I'm not saying that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will split the sea, but now this is the miracle of knowledge, the miracle of adhering to this religion. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will show us miracles if we go back to this book, if we go back to the Quran, and if we adhere to the instructions of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is what this series is about. This is what Al-Qasas is about. It is not about us having a great time in the best place that we can be in. And it is true. That is the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And there is nothing better than halaqat al-ilm. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to benefit me and you all with it. But it is for us to understand and to learn and to take this very seriously. Because that's our past and that's our future. When you read the stories, you're not reading history. You are learning for your future, inshallah, and our future, inshallah. The word qissa, or qasas, or story, actually qissa, the exact literal translation of qissa in Arabic, is story. And it's important to understand that when we use this word, is we know what it means. Qissa in the Arabic language can be only called for a true story, for something that actually happened. The story, you know, we sometimes mix the slang language with what the word really means. We say, don't tell me stories. And he's telling stories. Well, story, that we mean by that in our slang language is he's telling untruth. But the true meaning of the word, whether you take it in the Arabic, al-qissa, and this is from Lisan al-Arab to Ibn al-Mandur, this definition, he said, قَصَّ الْخَبَرَ أَعْلَمَهُ وَحَدَّثَ بِهِ عَلَى وَجْهِهِ. He said, Ibn al-Mandur, he said, to tell, to say the news. It's news, it's something that happened. أَعْلَمَهُ, to spread that information and the knowledge. وَحَدَّثَ بِهِ عَلَى وَجْهِهِ, the way it exactly happened. This is what qissa means. The way it exactly happened. Now, that's been twisted by the misuse of that language, even in the Arabic, that word, even in the Arabic language. That we say, what some author wrote a qissa. And that is not true. We should use other words like riwayah. You know, tales. But not a story. And if you go to the English dictionary, if you go to the Merriam-Webster dictionary, the American dictionary, you go to that this came, the story came from the old French, histoire. And that came from the Latin historia. And that means history. History is always the true account of something that happened. It is not fiction. When you say a story, it never means fiction. And that's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would not say the tales or say al-akhbar, al-riwayat. He said, they didn't say urwi lahum, he said qussa. قُصَّ عَلَيْهِمْ, tell them exactly what happened, the way it happened, delivered from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to his Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, الصادق الأمين, the truthful and the most honest. So with that, inshallah, we start the stories of the Qur'an. And with these stories, we start with the very first story, with the story of creation. When there was nothing but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Can Allah, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in a hadith sahih, he said, كان الله في عماء ما فوقه هواء وما تحته هواء ثم خلق عرشه على الماء. This hadith is in Tirmidhi and Ibn Majah and Ahmed, in Musnad Ahmed, rahimahumullah. And the Prophet ﷺ said, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala kana fi ama. There was nothing. Ama is complete vacuum. There was nothing but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What is above him was nothing, and what was below him was nothing. And then he created his throne, Azza wa ala. Kan Allah wa la makan. Allah was when there was no space. The concept of space is the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the ulama said, Allah kana wa la makan. Wa huwa ala ma kan. Qabla khalqi al makan lam yataghayyar amma kan. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was and there was no space and no place. And he is the way he was. He did not change. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as the ulama of Aqidah said, munazzahun anil hawadith. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is above changes. Changes occur to creation. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is ultimate and infinite and beyond a human understanding. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala يغير ولا يتغير. Allah changes, but He does not change. Subhanahu wa ta'ala. And there was Allah. And in the Quran, it is supported. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah Al-Hadid, He said, هو الأول والآخر والظاهر والباطن وهو بكل شيء عليم. He is the first and He is the last. There was a time that Allah tells us that there was nothing but Him. And there will come a time when there will be nothing but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, الحي الذي لا يموت. The live, Allah. And the ulama said, هو الأول بلا ابتداء والآخر بلا انتهاء. He is the first without a beginning. The first, when we say one first, we usually have this is the first, meaning there is a start. But the ulama said, He is al-awwal bil-abtida. He is the first without a beginning. وَهُوَ الْآخِرُ بِلَانْتِهَاء. And He is the last without an end. Subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then what happened? There comes the first creation. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala only knows the wisdom of the creation. We human beings, whenever we think about that, we are thinking using what? Human mind. We are using our human mind. And then we start and say, why did Allah create this? And what is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? And then we go into the trap of shaitan, into this ambush that the shaitan placed for us. Is we are unconsciously putting ourselves in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's position and trying to understand what happened. And that is not our position and it cannot be. It is the wisdom of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that is beyond human reach. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala explained some of it for us. But the things that we don't understand, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam taught us to say, آمنتُ بِاللَّهِ. I believe in Allah. And I believe in His creation, and I am submitting. Islam is about submission. I am submitting to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to His wisdom, and to His creation, and to His orders. Because I know I trust where it comes from. It comes from this glorious book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, through the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, through Jibreel alayhi salam. This is a chain that you can never find anywhere else in the universe, in creation. When you go through the people that narrate the Quran, and our Qurra probably know that, they say, I heard it from this, from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, from Jibreel, from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What a chain. And we know that this is the solid fact, and we have to believe in it. And the first creation that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created for His own wisdom, for what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala only knows, is al-arsh wal-qalam, the throne of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the pen. Now, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks of this al-arsh. Al-arsh is something that belongs to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala uses al-idafa, Rabbul Arsh al-Kareem. He is the Lord of the glorious throne. And what is that throne? And how it is? And what type of a throne it is? Allahu A'lam. This is a throne that is the roof of the highest degree of paradise. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in the authentic hadith, he said, when you ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala about Jannah, ask al-Firdaus al-A'la. Ask the highest level of Firdaus, of paradise. And that is above everything else in paradise. And immediately above it is Arsh al-Rahman. So when human beings started using the word throne, no matter what your imagination is, you're going to imagine a chair. You are going to imagine a chair. A glorious chair, big chair, but you cannot go beyond a chair. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala laysa kamithlihi shay. There is nothing like Him, and it is nothing like His creation. So this is something called al-ghaybiyat. These are the unseen. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala kept it like this till the day of judgment. When He reveals it to the highest people of paradise, and we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to be of them. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala praised his throne and he praised the pen. So the first creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala are these two things. Now, of course, when you say a pen, you will imagine a writing instrument, a pen. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala only knows what that pen is. That pen Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created in the beginning of creation, and he said, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered this pen to start writing everything that will happen. And this is hadith in Al-Bukhari and Muslim, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, after finished the creation, لَمَّا قَضَى اللَّهُ الْخَلْقِ كَتَبَ فِي كِتَابِهِ. He wrote, he finished the writing in his book, فَهُوَ عِنْدَهُ فَوْقَ الْعَرْشِ. And he placed it in his book above the throne, إِنَّ رَحْمَتِي غَلَبَتْ غَضَبِي. That my mercy overcome my anger. This is Rabbna, this is Allah al-Kareem al-Rahim. That when he finished all the events and finished all the creation, we will speak about that here in a minute. He wrote above his throne. And this is in Al-Bukhari and Muslim. إِنَّ رَحْمَتِي سَبَقَتْ غَضَبِي. That my mercy overcomes my wrath. So that's why we always remember that. Whenever we start anything, what do we say? Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. This is our hope. This is our only hope we have, wallahi. Is the rahmah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala confirmed that in the Quran. He said, كَتَبَ عَلَى نَفْسِهِ الرَّحْمَةِ. Allah ordained for himself, and no one can ordain for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ar-Rahmah, the mercy. And when he sent his prophet, he sent them with one mission. وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ إِلَّا رَحْمَةً لِلْعَالَمِينَ. We send you only Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam as a mercy to mankind. And that form of speech in Arabic, when you put negative with exception, meaning that is your only purpose. That's what you, why you are sent. النفي مع الاستثناء يفيد الحصر in Arabic. So meaning that is your sole purpose. You are sent, O Muhammad, as a rahmah. And what a messenger of rahmah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he was. Which one was created first? These are the three ahadith, and I would like to just get your attention to some things that we will do, inshallah, with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's help and support in this series. That we will try, as a group, and I ask your cooperation, to depend only on the hadith and the Quran and the solid narrations. Because you will read different things that has been narrated, and there, it's all over there. And there are some that seeped into the Muslim writings from the people before the Muslims. There are some Isra'iliyat. There are some things that came to our... And Rahimahullah Ibn Kathir, he put some of that, but he always, Al-Imam Al-Hafiz Ibn Kathir, he always refers to it as such. He always tells you where he brought that from. And just while we're speaking about this, as I digress a little bit, I want to tell you my references, because that is also very important to understand. And you always have to question the references of any speaker you have. And the references are basically dependent on what is called Ummahat al-Kutub, the mothers of the books, the essential references in our Islamic literature that speak about history and Qasas al-Anbiya. And one of the top of these books is the book of Qasas al-Anbiya, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَلَمْ يَكُنْ شَيْءٌ غَيْرًا. And there was nothing but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then, وَكَانَ عَرْشُهُ عَلَى الْمَاءِ. And then his throne over water. What kind of water? Where, this is all غيبيات. This is all unknown. We take it as it is and we say, آمَنَّ بِاللَّهِ. And then his throne. وَكَتَبَ فِي الذِّكْرِ كُلَّ شَيْءٍ. And then he wrote in اللوح المحفوظ everything. Everything that will ever happen from the beginning of creation till the end of time is written by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala before creation. ذلك الله. That is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then, وَخَلَقَ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ. Then heavens and earth were created. And that is the narration of Al-Bukhari. Another hadith narrated in Ahmed, like we reported in the beginning of this lecture, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was there was no place, there was nothing but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and then he created his throne. So according to the narration of Imam Ahmad, And this narration in Al-Bukhari, the first thing that was created is what? Is the throne of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But then you have Ahmad himself narrated in another source and reference, and also Abu Dawood and At-Tirmidhi, in the hadith of Ubad ibn Samit that he said, إِنَّ أَوَّلَ مَا خَلَقَ اللَّهُ الْقَلَمُ فَقَالَ لَهُ اكْتُبْ فَجَرَى بِمَا هُوَ كَائِنٌ إِلَى الْأَبَدِ. That the first thing that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created is the pen, is the qalam, noon wal qalam wa ma yasturun. And then he ordered Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala the pen to write everything till the day of judgment, till the end of time. And that pen wrote everything by the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So you have two different opinions among the ulama, but all agree that the first two things that were created were the throne of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the pen that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala recorded the history of not only humanity, history of everything that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created. And then comes the glorious creation of as-samawati wal-ard. خلق السماوات والأرض. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala recorded that creation of heavens and earth in many places in the Quran. And one of the verses that narrates that, and it shows the time that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala took to create heavens and earth, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in Surah Qaf, وَلَقَدْ خَلَقْنَا السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضَ وَمَا بَيْنَهُمَا فِي سِتَّةِ أَيَّامٍ وَمَا مَسَّنَا مِنْ لُغُوبٍ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created heavens and earth and all between them in 6 days. And nothing of fatigue touched us. No fatigue touched Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَهُوَ عَلَيْهِ هَيِّنٌ. And it was easy for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to create this universe, this glorious universe, that when we scratch its surface, we feel the amazing power of creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. All these galaxies, all these stars. If you look at just the earth that we live in, this magnificent planet, and if we just look into your own self, وَفِي أَنفُسِكُمْ أَفَلَا تُبْصِرُونَ. And in your own human body, can't you see the glory of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was not touched by fatigue or tiredness. And why is that important? Because the people of the book made a huge iftira on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. A huge falsehood when they said that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and they agree that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created heavens and earth in 6 days. But what did they say after that? He rested. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, لَقَدْ خَلَقْنَا السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضَ وَمَا بَيْنَهُمَا فِي سِتَّةِ أَيَّامٍ وَمَا not only وَمَا أَصَابَنَا وَمَا مَسَّنَا. He didn't say, I was not inflicted by fatigue. أَصَابَنَا. He said, I was not touched. Not even close to any fatigue. All that creation. And it is in 6 days. Now the ulama, the scholars, and you will see that in these books, they disagreed about what does that mean. What is the duration of 6 days? And that happened, these writings were, you know, Al-Hafidh ibn Kathir and ibn Jarir al-Tabari, these writings were about 700 to 1,000 years old. And it was for them still a matter of debate to say that a day with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not always mean a 24-hour day like we have. It can mean that. And that's where they had their debates and discussions. It is possible that these days were sunset, sunrise, night, till the next sunset, 24-hour normal day. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the book, He said, وَإِنَّ يَوْمًا عِنْدَ رَبِّكَ كَأَلْفِ سَنَةٍ مِمَّا تَعُدُّونَ. A day with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala like 1,000 years of your time. And in another place, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, تَعْرُجُ الْمَلَائِكَةُ وَالْرُوحُ إِلَيْهِ فِي يَوْمٍ كَانَ مِقْدَارُهُ 50,000 years. That Allah, the angels and the spirit in Jibreel alayhi salam ascend to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in a day, it is counted as 50,000 years of our time. So what does these 6 days mean? We say, Allahu A'lam. Allahu A'lam. And the ulama try to speak about that. And the entire creation took 6 days min ayyamillah. 6 days of the days of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And in Surah Fussilat, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives the tafsil. In Surah Fussilat, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us the details of these 6 days. And he said, أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم, قل إنكم لتكفرون بالذي خلق الأرض في يومين وتجعلون له أندادا ذلك رب العالمين وجعل فيها رواسي من فوقها وبارك فيها وقدر فيها أقواتها في 4 أيام سواء للسائلين ثم استوى إلى السماء وهي دخان فقال لها وللأرض ائتيا طوعا أو كرها قالتا أتينا طائعين. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, say, is it that you deny him who created the earth in 2 days? So the creation of the earth itself, as we know it, took 2 days of the days of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And do you join equals with him? He is the Lord of all the worlds. He sat on the earth mountains. He put the anchors. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala called the mountains. He said, rawasi, anchors. And this is a fact that was only known in our time, that the mountains that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala placed on the earth work like anchors, and they stabilize the crust over the earth. And here's the Quran, the word of the Creator himself. And he said, these are rawasi. And in some of the translation before these facts came out, you see that the translator takes this word and they did not understand that meaning and they put something else instead. And it is an important point that if you read Quran in Spanish or read it in English or you read it in any other language, to understand that you are reading the interpretation of that particular person only. You're not reading what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said. What you are reading is what that person thought Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said. And that's just the fact, that's the truth. These people just trying to interpret the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and jazahumullah khair, they do their best, but is that what exactly Allah said? That's not. So if you go, for example, to Yusuf Ali's version, the rawasi of mursa, it means an anchor, but you in Arabic, but you will not see that word in there. Took another word, and he said, and that if I'm not mistaken, he just put the mountain standing firm. Meaning the mountain itself is just placed in there. But the word in Arabic was an anchor, and now in the 21st century, science came to tell us that the anchor is the only word that can be used in that regard. This is a book that is very well fit together. كِتَابٌ أُحْكِمَتْ آيَاتُهُ. You cannot take one word and put any other words in it. And that is the meaning that we know today, and that may change later on. Science changes, but it cannot contradict the Quran. And whenever you see a contradiction between science and Quran, then you know that science will change. Be it simple. Always did. We have many, many examples to show. These are the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That was a little digression. And then, وَبَارَكَ فِيهَا. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blessed it, bestowed the blessing on the earth. And then he measured its sustenance for the dwellers on earth in 4 days. And 4 days, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala measured all the sustenance. He placed enough oil for people, enough grains for people, enough water for people, enough everything to sustain human life until Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will so. And he put every one single one of us what their portion of it is. It's done. It's a done deal. And it's done long, long time ago. So that's what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, when you ask, when you try to, then do it in a beautiful way. What is coming to you is already going to come to you. So do it in a halal way. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَفِي السَّمَاءِ رِزْقُكُمْ. Where is in the heavens your sustenance? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala already written it in this lawh mahfuz, and it is up there in heavens. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, I have that record. It's not going to change. وَفِي السَّمَاءِ رِزْقُكُمْ وَمَا تُوَعَدُونَ. And if you have any doubt, فَوَرَبِّ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ إِنَّهُ لَحَقٌ. مِثْلَ مَا أَنَّكُمْ تَنْطِقُونَ. By the Lord of heavens and earth, it is true. Like you speak. Like how you know you, like you speak in the words and you're sure that these words are coming out of my mouth. This is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, and he's not making his oath subhanahu wa ta'ala by the heavens or the sun or the teen or the zaytun. He said, وَرَبِّ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ. By the Lord of heavens and earth. Let no doubt be in your heart that your sustenance is measured and it's written, and it's kept with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So use only halal way to get it. It's coming to you. And if you use haram and you get it, you were going to get it anyway with halal. It is ordained for you. And how many people go haram way and they end up with nothing? Still, doesn't make any difference. And we have to have that faith. But the time that that took is 4 days combined. For the Mufassirun said there was combined for the creation of earth and the sustenance that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala divided and ordained for the natural resources for every human being, it was in 4 days. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala called upon the heavens and earth to come, and they came obedient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then, ثُمَّ اسْتَوَى إِلَى السَّمَاءِ وَهِيَ دُخَانٍ. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ascended or comprehended His design to the sky, to the heavens. وَهِيَ دُخَانٍ, and it was a smoke. And when do we know that the origin of planets and the solar system was smoke? 21st century. It's a cloud of smoke that formed the universe. This is a true scientific fact at this point. And here it is. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said the heavens was just a cloud of smoke. فَقَالَ لَهَا وَلِلْأَرْضِ اِتِيَا طَوْعًا أَوْ كَرْهًا قَالَتَ أَتَيْنَا طَائِعِينَ فَقَضَاهُنَّ سَبْعَ سَمَاوَاتٍ فِي يَوْمَيْنِ. And then he completed that creation, completed the creation of heavens in 2 days. So two for the earth, two for the creation of earth, and then 4 days included for the sustenance of earth, plus two for the heavens, that is a 6 day. And that is the detail of what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has done. And then he said in 2 days, وَأَوْحَى فِي كُلِّ سَمَاءٍ أَمْرَهَا, and assigned to each heaven its duty and its command and its function. And Allahu A'lam where these heavens are and what they mean. When we say seven heavens, who knows what that means? We don't know. When we say seven earth, who knows what that exactly means? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala a'lam. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us what we can take. He's telling us the things that we can take, and whatever goes beyond our understanding, we should be humble and modest before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and we say, Allahu A'lam. Allahu A'lam. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, we put the stars and the planets, وَحِفْظَ, and that is to protect heavens, ذَلِكَ تَقْدِيرُ الْعَزِيزِ الْعَلِيمِ. And one other, and I will inshallah conclude with these two verses about the creation of heavens and earth. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about some of the mechanism of creation. In Surah Al-Anbiya, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, أَوَلَمْ يَرَى الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا. Don't those who disbelieve know? And there is a clear sign that this particular mechanism would be revealed to the disbelievers. The Muslims, alhamdulillah, know this. And they have no question about, inshallah, Allah's creation. But those who disbelieve and they work with science and physics and cosmic physics and astronomy and quantum physics, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, أَوَلَمْ يَرَى الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا أَنَّ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ كَانَتَا رَتْقًا فَفَتَقْنَاهُمَا. That heavens and earth were joined together as ratq. Ratq is one big mass, one mass. فَفَتَقْنَاهُمَا. And we spread it. What do we call that in our modern history? The Big Bang. I mean, there is no other meaning that you can take, really. You have to imagine Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, it was rataq and fataq. This is that word that gives you that immediate spread, how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala opened this entire universe. And He said, it's like a book that was closed together and it was open, it was spread open. كَانَتَا رَتْقًا وَفَفَتَقْنَاهُمَا. Yet in the same verse, another miracle of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, scientific miracle. وَجَعَلْنَا مِنَ الْمَاءِ كُلَّ شَيْءٍ حَيٍّ. And we have created, made of water, everything that is alive. Every living thing has to have water. And now when scientists go out to look for life on different planets, what do they look for? They look for water. This is it. This is in the true book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That was revealed 1,427 years ago or before. That everything that is living is from this earth. أَفَلَا يُؤْمِنُونَ. Can they heed? Can they believe? Can they see that the one who is saying these words is the creator subhanahu wa ta'ala? Can they say that these words cannot come from any other person? Because they said about the Prophet Muhammad, he's a poet. They said the evil spirits come and give him these words. They say all kind of things. Now, can anyone other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say these words? And then I will leave you with the final verse that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speak about this universe. And he said, وَالسَّمَاءُ بَنَيْنَاهَا بِأَيْدٍ وَإِنَّا لَمُوسِعُونَ. And with power did we construct the heaven. Verily, we are able to extend the vastness of that space. What do we call that in today? Theories? The expanding universe. Now, this is a scientific fact that this universe that we live in is ongoing and expansion. And Allah says, وَإِنَّا لَمُوسِعُونَ. Now, it's a فِعْل مُضَارِع. It's a present. We are expanding. وَإِنَّا لَمُوسِعُونَ. We are expanding this. And this is Allah. ذَلِكُمُ اللَّهُ تَبَارَكَ اللَّهُ أَحْسَنُ الْخَالِقِينَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, these are my verses, these are my signs, and for those who do not believe, let them know. لَخَلْقُ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ أَكْبَرُ مِنْ خَلْقِ النَّاسِ وَلَكِنَّ أَكْثَرَ النَّاسِ لَا يَعْلَمُونَ. Surely the creation of heavens and earth is greater matter than the creation of men, yet most men understand not. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us of those who understand, and to make us of those when they read these verses, we get the guidance and the hikmah in our heart. And to make us of those who do not desert the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And to go on the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to learn more wisdom and more knowledge and increase our iman inshaAllah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we will stop there inshaAllah, and we will start with the creation of the angels inshaAllah with the next session. Jazakumullah khair. Subhana rabbika rabbil izzati amma yasifun. Wa salamun ala al-mursaleen. Walhamdulillahi rabbil alameen.